When you've been down in the opinion polls, a good result can be enough to lift the spirits. News polls still has the Coalition trailing Labor by 6 points post-budget, but an Ipsos Fairfax poll has them tied at 50-50, the Abbott government's best result in more than a year. It certainly put a spring in the step of Liberal Senators Dean Smith and Corey Bernardi, who were reviving calls for Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act to be changed. It's less than a year ago since Tony Abbott binned attempts to repeal sections of the Act, saying that he didn't want any needless complications in the government's relationship with the Muslim community.
I want the communities of our country to be our friend, not our critic. I want to work with the communities of our country as Team Australia here.
But Family First Senator Bob Day has introduced a private member's bill to amend Section 18C. At the moment, it includes this line.
It is unlawful for a person to do an act otherwise than in private if the act is reasonably likely in all the circumstances to offend, insult, humiliate or intimidate another person or a group of people.
The bill would remove the words offend and insult. The Communications Minister talked up that potential compromise when speaking to the commentator who was found to have breached the act, Andrew Bolt.
There was a very general consensus that the words insult and offend could be removed, leaving the words humiliate and intimidate. I think that was broadly supported across the board, and I was very comfortable about that. I didn't think that would have any sort of negative impact.
Liberal Senator Corey Bernardi is one of the co-sponsors of Bob Day's bill, and he joined me a short time ago from our Adelaide studio. Corey Bernardi, welcome to Late Line.
Thanks very much, Emma.
On the issue of Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act, are we now going to see some changes?
Well, I certainly hope so. The government's position when they first announced they were going to change it was meant to be a starting point, not an ending point. And when they abandoned the idea of reform of 18C, a group of us got together and we supported a bill to remove insult and offend from Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act. It now appears that that's met with widespread acclaim, and Malcolm Turnbull is the latest to join what I would call the common sense revolution.
What evidence is there that free speech is being seriously curtailed in this country?
Well, there's any number of instances where people feel that they could be dragged before a tribunal or for simply causing insult or offence. And that's a very subjective clause. I'd rather remove that so that people can feel they can speak in a manner that may in fact cause offence, but it will be counted in the court of public opinion. I just think it's an important prerequisite for a country which is going to face enormous challenges in the future, and I think we need to obviously reform 18C.
To what extent is your opinion on this being driven by a sense that Herald Sun columnist Andrew Bolt experienced some kind of injustice when he was taken on over 18C?
Well, I think there's been a perception that there was an injustice done, and the Prime Minister himself said he wouldn't like to see that repeated. But, you know, ultimately, if you've got such a subjective test as insult and offend in a freedom of speech provision, I think we're limiting our freedom of speech. And because it is such a subjective term. If I feel offended by what someone says about me, it doesn't mean I should be able to take them to court or haul them before a tribunal, and all that engages. And it's also acts as some sort of character assassination, if you will, because then people can parade that around and say, well, so-and-so was taken to court because they upset someone else.
But it's more than that, isn't it? Because this is specifically about racial discrimination. So it's not just about offending or insulting you generally. It's offending or insulting you on account of your race. And in the case of Andrew Bolt's two columns in the country's biggest selling newspaper, they implied that light-skinned people who identified as Aboriginal did so for personal gain, and the judge concluded that he made at least 19 errors of fact and one gross error of fact. Is that the kind of opinion, speech you want to be able to protect?
Well, I want to protect all freedom of speech in this country, even that I don't agree with. And by the same measure, I could say when people refer to, you know, rich old white men as some way of dismissing, you know, a position or an opinion, is that offensive? Is that insulting? Some would argue it is, but should it go to court? I would say no. The best way to counter bad or offensive opinions is to, through the court of public opinion, and to have robust debate upon it. And if any columnist wants to write something, then they should be free to do so within the bounds of the law, and I think that's a healthy thing for our democracy.
Almost 12 months ago now, Tony Abbott said he made a leadership call, a captain's call, if you will, to abandon changes to Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act, as they were, quote, a needless complication in the government's relationship with the Australian Muslim community. So what's changed since then?
Well, I think the budget perhaps has suggested that a government that repositions itself and determines the priorities that are in accordance with mainstream community opinion can do very, very well. I'd like to see us revisit Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act. I think it's important for people, and I think it's very symbolic that to remove the provisions, the very simple provisions, insult and offend, and if you're in any doubt about how inoffensive that change is, you can just examine the broad cross-section of the community from Julian Burnside QC right through to Andrew Bolt, who suggests it's a very good start.
Let's move on. What's your problem with halal food?
I've instigated an inquiry into food certification schemes in our country. There seems to be a growing community concern about aspects of the certification industry. Some claim it's a rort, some object to supporting religious taxes as they've characterised them. Others question the efficacy, the efficiency of doing it, and some people want increased transparency. The fact that there are concerns in this space, I think, is reflected by the fact that the Organic Council have come out, the Food and Grocery Council have come out, the kosher certification schemes have come out and said they welcome this inquiry because it will alleviate any misapprehensions in the community.
You've previously referred to halal certification as a racket. What did you mean by that?
Well, I think if you're being asked by organisations to subscribe to some certification scheme which is unnecessary, which only applies to a tiny subsection of the community and is not transparent, you can attach such labels to it. But what I'm interested in doing is getting to the bottom of it, to establishing what the facts are, because I get hundreds of questions about halal and other certification schemes, and I'm unable to answer them because I can't get answers to the questions myself. I've sought to get to the bottom of some of the insinuations that have come my way, and I'm unable to do it. So I think a Senate inquiry is one way of establishing the facts.
One Nation founder Pauline Hanson reckons halal certification is a $3 trillion industry that funds terrorism. Do you share those concerns?
Well, there's no doubt that it's a big industry, and even the World Halal Authority suggests it's in the trillions of dollars. There has been evidence internationally where halal certification fees have ended up in with prescribed organisations, including Hamas and Hezbollah. The National Crime Commission hasn't found any direct evidence of that in Australia. But, you know, there is widespread community concerns. If we can establish the facts and alleviate those concerns, I think that's healthy for our country.
You mentioned yourself that the Australian Crime Commission says there's no evidence halal certification money is funding terrorism. So why do you think a parliamentary inquiry can find something different?
Emma, the parliamentary inquiry is into certification schemes. That's the first thing. The National Crime Commission found that there was no direct link from any legitimate halal certification authority directly to money laundering or any terrorist organisations. Now, that doesn't mean, of course, that some money isn't flowing into organisations that are fostering or cultivating extremism at some level. I don't know whether that's true or not. But look, let's examine certification schemes in this country. Let's compare and contrast how they operate and find out what's the best method forward. There are many questions that I have, and I'd like to get to the bottom of some of them on behalf of the Australian community.
Do you see it as your government's role to speak out against racism?
Oh, of course. I think government has a role to play in the social fabric of society. Absolutely.
So you would understand that on this halal issue, some people see it as simply anti-Islam?
But Islam's not a race, Emma, so I'm not sure how you segue from racism into Islam. You can become a Muslim simply by pledging your allegiance to Allah and Muhammad as his messenger. It doesn't change your race.
Before we go, I'm curious about a tweet you wrote the other day on the issue of the UK election. You were wishing someone good luck, but it wasn't David Cameron or the Conservatives. It was the UK Independence Party and its leader, Nigel Farage.
Yeah, well, that's quite right. I think the UK Independence Party has a very important role in British politics. I think they helped drag the Cameron government into a more sustainable Conservative position. And that was reflected by the fact that they now have a majority. What I lament is the fact that the UK Independence Party got millions and millions of votes and only one seat. And I think Douglas Carswell's an excellent member for them.
You'd be aware that David Cameron refused to debate Nigel Farage. In fact, he once said UKIP was, quote, full of fruitcakes, loonies and closet racists.
Oh, yes, he did, because he was dismissing them at the time. But, of course, David Cameron failed to win a majority in that right in 2010 and was captive to the left and the Liberal Democrats. I think he's since seen the error of his ways, and he's recognised that UKIP reflects a great many concerns of regular Britons, and quite frankly, in this country, I want to make sure that the mainstream political parties also represent mainstream concerns and don't dismiss them as Mr. Cameron did, because otherwise we will see the rise of third party voting in this country, and I don't think that's quite healthy for us at the moment.
You said in that tweet that both our nations need more straight talk and common sense. Is it common sense when Nigel Farage calls for a ban on people with HIV and AIDS entering the UK?
Oh, well, I think common sense is in short supply, particularly in politics. And, you know, I call it the common sense revolution. You've just got to think about the practical implications of what is going on when we're making legislative decisions. Now, the fact that I think UKIP is an important force for good in British politics, and I think it reflects the concerns of many mainstream Britons and people right around the world, quite frankly, doesn't mean I'm going to agree with every political position they put forward. So, you know, they can deal with their electorate there and I'll deal with mine here.
Of course, their central pillar is to take the UK out of the EU.
Yeah, and you know what? David Cameron's committed to having a referendum on that. He was dragged kicking and screaming into it, but he's committed to doing it. And you know what? There's a good chance it could get up.
Corey Bernardi, we're out of time. Thank you very much.
It's my pleasure. Thanks, Emma.